This is last seminar, actually it is not a seminar, it is a workshop, and it is important to address this issue because the last meeting were organizing in terms of web meetings, and now it is organizing in terms of a Zoom meeting. I think that a Zoom meeting is better because it can allow more participation of the audience. This is the last session, and the idea here is to create a business case for responsible innovation. So let's move on. Good, interesting concept is to understand well why we intend to have responsible innovation. There are essentially three causes for that. The first thing is to look for new technologies, so a technological point of view. That is that I want to create new technologies. When I say we, I mean research centers, I mean private companies, public companies. So they want to place in market new technologies that really work for society without causing more difficulties than they solve. Other important thing to address is the question relates to looking for solutions that can create value to people. It is very important, this concept of create value that really are important for people. And the last one is more ambitious and more conceptual, that is turning the world in a better place to live. So that's why responsible innovation is really important. However, the last slide is too theoretical and too conceptual because it doesn't say nothing related to apply it in practice. When we intend to apply it, there are some alternatives. First thing is to ensure that the research that is performance and the product achieve a social or environment benefit. Another important thing is to consider the current needs, but also the needs of next generations, considering several dimensions like social, ethical, environmental, cultural. So it is important not looking just to one perspective, but including multiple components. Another important thing is about the involvement of social needs from the beginning of the process, so the beginning of the innovation process. Why it is very relevant that, considering the last presentations, not only mine, but the others, it is important to know that the responsible innovation framework that presented in the context of this course, considering the use and adoption of Agile. Agile, it is an interesting perspective because the social needs can be implemented just from the beginning of the process and not only at the end. And the last two points are also important, that is related to anticipate and imagine problems and opportunities, and also considering that the markets and knowledge are dynamic. And therefore, it is important to place the social, ethical, environmental, and cultural impacts really in the context of the markets that are addressed. Looking to key values in implementing responsible innovation, it is important to state some key values that are really interesting. Here in this slide are presented the eight. The first one is related to purpose-oriented, so it must have a goal, typically a social goal, but it can have another component like cultural goal, like environmental goal. It is also important to address metrics like risk-benefit analysis and monitoring. And don't forget the last part that is possibly more important than a poor analysis in the beginning of the process. A user-centered design. That's why also agile innovation is important, because the user is always in the center of the process. then appears two components that are more related to ethical, that is transparency and moral justification. The other thing below is involving all stakeholders. This is a very important issue because I know that everybody is talking about the involvement of stakeholders. Everybody agrees that the involvement of stakeholders is very important. However, in practice, it is not easy to implement, and I know it very well. Why it happens? Because the involvement of stakeholders needs time for that. So when a company wants to perform, for example, a strategic decision, strategic decisions are typically very important, and of course they need time to be taken, and they need time to be considered and analyzing. However, sometimes, and everybody knows that, it is not always possible to involve all stakeholders. Why? Because there is no time for that. Some decisions need to be taken in just a few days or weeks, and the involvement of stakeholders need time. And this is a very important aspect in responsible innovation, because involvement of stakeholders is really very important, and not only looking to the perspective of the one company. After that appears the human and social aspects, and also the context awareness. It is also a very important topic, this last one, because context means, for example, cultural aspects, mean also geographic aspects. So responsible innovation in Portuguese context can be different, for example, in Africa context or in Brazilian context. So you need to address really the needs of the place that you are implementing the responsible innovation. It is an interesting point, this one, that is most responsible companies. I will share my screen, stop sharing my screen at this point, just to put this link also here in chat, that I think it is interesting to see. Just some seconds to put it in chat. Okay. And I will also share my screen and share this site. Okay, I think that everybody is there reading it, okay? And this is an interesting publication that looks to the Americans' most responsible companies in 2021. And why it is relevant? Because there isn't only one metric, there are several metrics. In this case, it is a metric applying only to companies in America, and includes three pillars: environmental, social, and corporate governance. And it reached some interesting conclusions. So looking here, it says that 9 of the top 20 companies are in tech. It is a very interesting conclusion because it has some consequences. Looking to our model that is inspired in agile innovation, initially begin in the context of IT companies. Then it moved to our other fields, like industry, like health, like retail, for example. But initially, it was applied in the context of IT, particularly Scrum. In fact, there are other paradigms like for example, Lean, that appear in the context of Toyota, that is an industrial environment. But the majority of Agile is applying currently in the context of IT companies. So it reached an interesting conclusion that probably adopting Agile is a good contribution to web responsible organization. And IT organizations are better prepared for this challenge. In first place appears Agapi, then NVIDIA, Microsoft, Cisco, and other ones. Besides first place are tech companies, IT companies. And that's what I want to present. That I provide also the link. So let's move to the PowerPoint again. Okay. Okay. And now I'm also sharing the PowerPoint. So also an emergent topic related with this one, related with responsible innovation, is in context of COVID-19. Why it is an emergent topic? Because COVID-19 is something new, of course, but it caused really a deep impact in the market. I believe, or in my opinion, that responsible innovation was an interesting topic that was pertinent for essentially for big companies in the world before COVID-19. But after that, I realized that a lot of companies are talking about it, and they have some movements that implement the responsible innovation in the context of less organizations. One of them emerged in Portugal that I participate, that is called Tech for COVID-19. And the idea is very interesting, is that all startups and small companies that are typically innovative companies can collaborate to place in the market some solutions that address COVID-19's challenge. The movement has currently more than 5,000 professionals, including IT people, that is majority, but it has other people like designers, like marketers, like health professionals. So it is really a big movement that has a huge impact, of course, in the context of our lives, but also with the support of public organizations. This movement is also interesting looking for it for another point of view. That is the implementation of the paradigm associated with human to human. What is human to human? It's an interesting topic. It is not really new. I have published some articles recently about COVID-19 and about the Tech for COVID movement in top journals. But really an interesting issue is that human to human is not a new concept, but the importance of this concept is really new. Because when you try to characterize the relationships between the companies and the business, you have some paradigms that are well established in the market, like business to business, business to consumer, B2B, B2C, C2C. That's models that everybody knows very well. But human to human is something that is not so popular. What is the concept? The concept emerged in terms of responsible innovation that you are providing something that is developed by human and address the human. So it is something that really has a social impact. So this is the paradigm of human to human. It is a very interesting topic. And the idea for this workshop, what is the idea? The idea is to implement a tool that can assess how responsible innovation you are. You are, and when I say you are, I'm saying about your company. So the Compass tool was developed in the context of an European project. The idea is the integration of responsible innovation practices in the innovation management process. It targets essentially small and medium-sized companies, and it has a checklist composed of 50 questions that evaluate your company in terms of responsible innovation. So you can assess how responsible innovation is your company by looking to different perspectives. The Compass tool is composed by four dimensions. First one is company management, idea generation and research, development and testing, and marketing and impact. Okay, It was initiated in the context of an European project. And looking to these components, first one is company management. Company management is composed by some sub-dimensions, like mission, ethical conduct, data management, transparency, participation standards, diversity and equality, employee health and safety, and employee responsibility. The idea here is to evaluate your company from a top vision that is relevant, that your employees feel that they really can contribute to responsible innovation inside the organization. The second component is the idea generation and research. And the idea here is to look to the beginning of the innovation process, from the process of creation of idea, to have an idea, and research to implement it after that. After that appears the deployment and test phase. Here, it is important to look to how the innovation process is really deployed in terms of your company, that includes the production, the text, and until the market end. And the last one is related with market and impact. It is the last final stage. And really here, look for examples to assess how your company is contributing to solve societal challenges, minimizing negative effects, and reviewing and adapting. So it is related to the process of launch in market, and we reevaluate the process. And that's all in terms of presentation. And now begins the part that I consider more relevant, that is the exercise. It depends on the number of participants in this session, but the idea is the following. I will present also the idea, also the Compass tool that I will present, and after that, the idea is to start collaborating. So the first step is to organize in teams. I suggest between 5 or 8 persons. And here is the following. There are two alternatives to implement an exercise like that. First option is to consider an incumbent company in the market and evaluate how this company is responsible innovation. It is an interesting exercise, I agree. But it is not possible, at least in the context of this presentation. Why? Because there are the IP rights that should be addressed. And of course, it wouldn't be possible. So another alternative that I think it is also very interesting is consider a new business idea that will be the base for the creation of a new startup. So you start by having a business idea in a brainstorming session that will create a new startup. After that, after you have a business idea, you can create the business model canvas. I believe that everybody knows what is business model canvas. It is a visual presentation of your business in terms of different components. It is interesting, the business model canvas, because it was proposed by Alexander Osterwalder in the context of his PhD to university, I don't know, it was in Switzerland. I don't know if it was university, I think that was ATL, but I'm not sure what was the university. But in the time that he was working in the business model canvas, I was also attending my PhD at the University of Porto, and I collaborate with it in this process of the creation of business model canvas, because my PhD was related to the creation of new business models for telecommunication companies. So I collaborate with him in this process of creation of the business model canvas. There is a visual model to create it online that I have here at link, and I will share it in chat after that. that provides the opportunity to create the business model canvas online without the need to install something. After that you have the business model canvas, you can start evaluate your startup. You will use the Compass tool for that. There is also a direct web link that is provided in Google Drive, but it's also possible to go to the website of the project because it is an European project that is public, and download the Excel. It is exactly the same Excel. And the last one is an interesting point. It's share learning outcomes and issues. Why it is important, last one? Because the Compass tool, it has 50 questions. Some of them are very easy to answer. Others are not so easy, are not so easy to understand, and essentially are not so easy to evaluate. Okay, so I will stop sharing my screen and starting work with the participants in the process of creation the business idea and the business model canvas before starting to evaluate using Compass. But after I stop sharing my screen, I will also share the Excel file to present how it can be evaluated. So let's move to the Excel. Let me start share again and move to the Excel. Okay. Now I'm in the Excel. This Excel can be downloaded from these URLs that I will provide here in chat. The first tab is about tool. It is a brief description of Compass Responsible Innovation tool. It is not really nothing new because I already presented it. The next tab is about overview and results. It is interesting. First thing is put here the company name, and after that, it is evaluate your company in terms of responsible innovation. Consider the dimensions company management, idea generation and research, development and testing, and market impact. The evaluation is done in each subdimension, and also it aggregates and provides a global score between 0 and 100 of your responsible innovation in terms of the four components. But you need to provide inputs of your evaluation of your company here. So, for example, mission, there are some questions related with it. Okay. For example, the first one is that if you are pursuing innovations that can improve lives and/or environmental sustainability, the second one is developing innovation in consultation with users and society. And if you provide a check, the score will also change accordingly. Okay. And they are also typically in all sublimations, there is also an alternative answer related with the other. And you can write what you are implementing in your company. And after that, the overview and the results will also be changed according to your scores that you give here. Also, the same applies to idea generation research, development and testing, and market and impact. So my idea is really to implement it, considering a new business of a new startup. And so I will stop sharing my screen and start working. Okay. So the number of participants, in my opinion, it has 8, but 8 counting with me and Katarina. So 6, 5, 6. Okay. So I think it is not needed to create groups, but you can work in this room. Everybody agrees with that? Everybody agrees with this idea to starting working in this room? Rosa, are you here? Rosa Romero. You have,
Yes.
yes. Do you agree with this idea to work together? In this,
I guess so.
okay, thank you very much. So, what is the first step of the process? First step, I will also provide here the in chat the links that I have in my presentation, but I think that you don't have in your site. First link is related with the business model canvas, like I told. Okay, that's what you need. Yeah. So what is the first component? I would like that everybody that is here participates. The first point is to create a new startup. So to create a new startup, it is not an easy process. Of course, there are a lot of things, but a good starting point, that is only 1% of a new startup. Don't forget that, because I had students that said to me that having a good idea is enough to have a good market. Not the case, okay? It is only 1%, but it is a good starting point. And the good starting point here is to create to have a business idea. So what can be a business idea? So anyone can say something about a business idea, have a business idea. Can be in IT, can be in retail, in health, in anything that you want. In tourism, what do you think? What can be a good idea? Anyone wants to participate?
Could it be in teaching?
Yes, yes, can it be.
Teaching for in online teaching, something like that, that is new from now?
Yes, yes. It is not exactly a new paradigm, but yeah. The impact of this paradigm is new. Okay, so let's start. I will also write here in chat. Online education. Okay, that's the topic of our business idea. So, but in the business idea, what really is new in this business idea? If you want to address the value proposition, that you need to have something that is unique and is really important for the customer and society, that can be customers or not. What do you say that that you want to have in online education? Can you say more about it, about our idea of the online education?
Yes, I could say something, but I'm new with this business model, so I'm trying to learn, of course. But I think the point is for most of the, if we situate the business in Portugal, for instance, from Portugal and from resources from a school of Portugal, we have a problem of language because we have teachers that don't speak English. And so we have to project it probably in different dimensions, if it is in English or if it is for Portuguese speaking countries. So we have to think about what is our target from the beginning.
Well, I see you're really interesting idea.
I would like to focus in international, from English, teaching English in English.
Well, but you can think in something innovative and very interesting. You said that some teachers don't know English or don't know very well English. It is true. And it is important to have something that could translate immediately to other language. For example, a teacher that knows very well Portuguese, but doesn't know so well English. So he can prepare everything in Portuguese and present in Portuguese, and the system will immediately translate everything to English. Do you think that it is an interesting idea?
For me, no. For me, it would be more interesting to have teachers from different parts of the world and different experience. And so this is more enrichment for students, I think, because it's different backgrounds that can come together.
Okay, probably. But you are assuming that everybody knows English. Your students know English.
Yeah, we have to manage, probably in a Portuguese institution, we have to manage different products, and one of the products could be with some teachers from the school and incorporating other teachers from over the world.
Mm-hmm. Interesting point. So you have an online education platform. Mm-hmm. So I'm also writing here that that provides some different online platform that provides course some different teachers in the world. Okay, that's the idea. Interesting one. And you have an institution that is focused in higher education, okay? And you have some teachers collaborating from different parts of the world. So it. Okay, I agree, it is an interesting idea. So let's start and move to business model canvas, okay? Let's create it, let's create together business model canvas. Just let me to copy the URL to my site, and also I will share my screen, that work better, like that. Share my screen. I will share the website, okay? But let's go and provide the name, online education, okay? And we'll start. Everybody seeing the screen, yes?
Yeah.
So like I told, this is a visual paradigm. It is interesting because when Osterwalder proposed this model, of course, there was a business plan, a lot of models for business plans, but all business plans were too descriptive and not visually. So visually, it has another impact, and it's easy to realize what are the key components of your business. So key partners, what can be key partners? Key partners can be other universities, so universities. Can also be, for example,
companies also.
Yes. Yes, it is interesting to have companies because I realize that my institution, and my institution is interesting because of that, because the University of Sport, where also I'm PhD advisor, and I'm also collaborating with other international universities. Companies are not so involved in the problems, in programs. So it is interesting that companies can provide their input and really collaborate in context of its discipline. So companies. So key partners, I think that, of course, there can be more, but it is okay. Key activities. What are the key activities?
Could be post-graduations.
Yes,
because it's easier in case of Portugal, because the accreditation process is out of the accreditation process.
Yes, it is easy, but it is not easy to attract students. I know that very well.
Yeah.
Yes.
Could also be short training.
Exactly. It is something that the University of Sport is always saying that needs to be improved. And I agree totally, but it is not easy because our system is too focused in the process of a rigid structure and not exactly to have a small course. But for and these can be the key activities. Key resource, what can be?
Qualified teachers, of course.
Let me. Let me stop sharing this screen because I have an account, but not account with this, this email. Let me check if they send me the email. Just to... I was checking the spam. They don't. Just some seconds. Just to. Okay. No problem. Let's move to work that work because they don't send to me the link. Okay. Let's move to work. Okay. Okay. Let's share again the screen. Okay. I was passing the information that I have online that needs to create an account. The key resource can be what? The.
I qualify the teachers.
Yes.
And of course, technology.
Yes, I was thinking about it. Platforms.
And I think the network could be, because if you have a network.
Yes, and it is important to have a good network to support all system. Okay. Value propositions. What is key here in terms of value propositions?
The value created for the students, do you mean this or it means another thing?
Can be.
Or it's the values, like strategic values or something like that. I don't know what is.
The idea here. In terms of value proposition, is to know what is really important in your business. Sorry, your customers. Okay. What really your customers want that make difference in the market and don't go to, for example, to competitors.
Yeah. Okay. Value
students.
I think one important issue or aspect is that you can do on-demand courses. You don't need to be all people at the same time and you can do your course at your own speed.
Yes, yes, I agree. It is very important because it is interesting because the paradigm is not exactly on-demand course. It is exactly the opposite. You have a list of course, you enroll in them, but if you want something, it is not easy. Okay? And I think that looking to the opposite, it is interesting because it is what market needs. Customer relationships. How do you interact with the customers? Strategy for that? Typically, I think that is the online system. Okay.
Yeah, but you can also have some kind of events to diffuse the product. So, for instance, I'm thinking about some experience from Instituto Empresa in Madrid. They have online courses, but in some periods they have a meeting in a different country, so and where the students come from over the world to that point. And of course, this is a way of diffusing also.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different experience that they, because they live a period, different time, different experience, and they, and this is important. It's like when you go to a conference and sometimes you remember the lunch, if it mm-hmm. is in a good country, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you remember the food. So it's interesting.
Yes, yes, it was interesting because it gives some elements for the creation also on demand course.
Yeah.
It gives some interesting inputs for that. Channels. I believe that is only online. But they can also be local partners, for example.
Yes.
After that appears the customer segments. It was also, I think that they are two customer segments. Customer segments relate to either with students, higher education students.
Yeah, could be more focused, could be manager.
Exactly.
Students, or could be a more a discipline.
Mm-hmm. For example, engineering studies.
Oh, yes, also.
Okay.
I also think that people with that are old, I think they are now using a lot of internet and a lot of tools, and they are now getting to into the network, I say. So I don't know how to call it, alumni, yeah.
Alumni community. And I'm also the leading of an alumni community at University of Sport.
Mm-hmm.
It is very interesting. It is not easy to manage so big community, but it's interesting because they have really different needs from the province.
Mm-hmm.
And after that appears the cost. That is essentially related with teachers and IT equipment.
Yes, and that and other licenses for access mm-hmm. to different platforms.
Yes. Yes, it may be relevant. And the last point is revenue streams. The idea is to create something quickly and not really with a bad equity. Revenue streams, how to get money from this company. So revenue is the...
The fees?
Yes.
The students pay a fee?
There are more.
I think there are more, but could be another business, probably.
Yes.
More, we can combine different types of business. And mm-hmm. of course, we can have more, but related with teaching.
Mm-hmm.
Probably okay. we can have some support from governmental institutions.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me add that. That is which is important, particularly in Portugal. In other countries, they are not so important. Now I think that everybody agrees with this business idea. At least when you implement business model canvas, that is more visual than disciples. But that problem related with my account, this is in text, but at least that idea is to create blocks in each component with it. But after this activity, And these activities should be performed together in a brainstorming activity like that. Of course, a personal interaction is better than online. But after this exercise, you have a good idea, a good overview about your company. Okay. And let me stop sharing again to start sharing the Excel. I also have the Excel. And okay, let's start here. Overview, let me uncheck that. Okay. Now you are applying the Compass tool to evaluate how responsible innovation is your company. Okay. Your company, the name, for example, online education. That's the name of your company. Of course, in practical, the name will be other. And of course, the business will not be exactly like that. You have the name of online education or your company name, and we'll start to evaluate your responsible innovation in terms of company management, idea generation and research, development and testing, and market and impact. At this point, look, the first exercise was to have an idea for a business, that is the online education or company. And after that, you create the business model canvas. But until this point, you don't have nothing related to responsible innovation. What you have in terms of implementation of responsible innovation is what you are implementing in the context of your organization. After the implementation of your strategy, that is not possible to simulate because it takes time as process of management a company, you can evaluate your company in terms of management, in terms of idea and research, development and testing and market impact. Let's start by the first one, that is company and management. And the idea is to consider the company, the startup that was created in this process. So let's start by the mission. First thing that typically you have a mission statement of your company that is typically written in a business plan, also in the website. So the mission of the company is probably the most important element of your company and tells exactly what you are providing to your customers and to society. So the first thing is seeing innovation that can improve lives and environmental sustainability. Do you believe that your business that you create, the online education, address this issue or not?
Yes.
Yes. How can it really have impact, for example, in terms of environmental impact?
For example, if we accept people from different countries with from different religions, from different races, so we are providing a social sustainability.
Yes, and if you have online education, you are also avoiding the location of students and other things. Okay? That is also important in terms of the environment. Okay, so check one. Second one is about developing innovation in consultation with the users and society. I think that yes, also, because in this business, you also want to have ideas about how to implement it, and it has impact in society. Okay. After that appears contributing to the advancement of science by sharing data with others. What do you think about it?
I think it could be more related with other business, because I think I'm thinking about sharing something new.
Mm-hmm. Sharing data. Of course,
education is sharing, is a process of sharing knowledge.
But data and knowledge is not exactly the same thing.
Yeah, I think it's not the same. Yeah.
Yes, isso sharing data is like that you share your, for example, your course.
For example, if I think in a big company that share with have an alliance with other companies and share information, so it is in this point I can expand my business because I trust in other companies and I can share information, and so this is an important issue in my for standing my business, for increasing my business. Okay. I don't know if it is the point here.
No, my interpretation of this is that it is not the point. I agree with you. Okay, so let's remain unchecked. And the next one is increasing public understanding about scientific progress. I think that this one should be checked, attending the domain of this business. Okay, they are other or not? The other is always the most difficult part to fill. In the mission of your company, that there are principles of responsible innovation that you really address.
Yeah, it depends. If you think about scholarship, probably you can include, and if you look at the development goals from United Nations, sorry, we can probably find something more.
Yes, but there are other components. Okay, there are other components. Mm-hmm. Anyway, check.
For instance, if you are working internationally, probably it could be, and online, it could be an important point in gender in some countries. So,
Yes. Well, Afghanistan is a good example of it, because the access to education for humans, for example. Okay. And the other, if there are some principles that are not exactly in the mission statement, but you really adopt. Yes, because if you really realize the previous one, you have also this one. Okay. And this component, 83%, what is really good in terms of mission of your organization. Ethical conduct, there is a lot of things to do.
Yeah.
First thing is the principles of post innovation that are addressed in your company called OSCAD. Ethical research conduct, I think it is mandatory in online education. And also in education in general. Okay. This one also, water boarding. Okay. Possible management of research data. I think that in education institution, it is mandatory to have that. This one is typically yes. This one is also very important. And it is common, so, for example, in publications. To have to present the potential conflict of interest and also the standing support. This one is not so easy to evaluate in this case. That is the involvement of stakeholders, like it was presented, like it is really very important in responsible innovation. Depends what do you see as stakeholders here and if they can involve or not innovation of process. Can you say something about it?
Yes. For instance, in Portugal, we have to do this with accreditation processes. We have to involve stakeholders.
Yes, but they are really involved in practical terms.
We have to involve people, including the. We have to involve not just the students.
Yes. I know that very well. But what I was saying is that typically you want to have a declaration. Okay, but not exactly consulting, because consulting, in my opinion, of course, but consulting, it has some consequence. and not exactly something to validate what you want. Okay.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, but it means that we then in practice we do that. Probably we don't do in that way, but usually it's important to look.
Yes. There is a reason to don't do that in a proper way, because it is the question or the notion of time, like I told in my presentation, because typically you don't have time to involve stakeholders.
And so it's an interesting point, because including companies, big companies now have to report information about these issues. So about their relation with stakeholders, many specific information about diversity in the company, including gender in the top level management.
Exactly, is having this issue, a very important issue in context of InexTech. And it is an interesting point, because in my opinion, of course, there are a lot of documents and a lot of rules to adopt the involvement of stakeholders. But I realize, since from my experience in the management field and also in education, that really stakeholders are not very involved, because some of them are not really ready to be involved also. But I think that in education it is critical to be
if your scope is international, you need it. If it is not just a traditional way, you need it for increasing your business.
Okay, I agree. Next, special case of vulnerable research participants. I think it's agree, because also talking about the scholarships, appears here, match here. The other doesn't make sense in this context. Okay. After peer or other category related with other, that is not easy to answer if you don't have really a business. Okay. Then there is also an option that some companies that don't have a codigo set on codigos conduct, but are really adopting it without a document. Mm-hmm. It happens sometimes in a smaller organization. And let's move to the next category, that is which following statements applies to your company code of ethics and codigos conduct. The document is publicly accessible. I think it is also a rule, also a trezesh, to have evaluation and these kind of components available online. The document should be reviewed periodically. It means that if you have implemented, and it is an interesting point, this one, because when talking about responsible innovation, and for example, the seminar provided by Ricky Fernandez that talked about the innovation management process, DISO rules. Typically, you have in your organization a quality management system. So if you have a quality management system, you need, of course, to have a commitment with some rules. And one of them is to have the information accessible and also review periodically. Okay. If employees are involved in the development of the document, typically, yes, makes sense. External stakeholders, in terms of education, like talk, yearly, it is very important, the involvement of stakeholders. Standards, say standards, they are standards on the education. So
yes, they need to
be applied. Yes. Document as guidelines and procedure to dealing with it. Yes and no, can be possible or not. I think that can be unchecked at this point. New employers are informed about the document, its contents and enforcements. Typically, yes, it is important when new employers appears in the organization. If this one is related with training, training is also an important component, so yes. And the document outlines employee responsibilities, typically yes, these kind of documents. Okay, and of course there are other section with other. Then appears something interesting, that is the ethics committee. Why it is really very important? I don't know if the audience, but the participants here can say when they are working. I believe that most of them are working in education, but others are working also in private companies. Someone wants to say something about it, if they have or not an ethical committee. In Portuguese, Comissão de Ética.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, typically yes. Do you have? Are you involved in an education institution, in a private company?
Yes, I'm involved in education, but I'm not. I don't belong to the ethic commission.
Okay, but there is ethical commission.
But we have ethical commission, yes.
Yes, yes. It's very important in some publications. It is an interesting point because there are some publications that really don't address this issue, but there are others. Typically, when involving, and is related with the second question, with human participation or animal experiments, that is mandatory. And there are others published that really request that always when you submit something, even if it doesn't as human participation. So, yeah. So let's consider that. Yes,
and we have simple issues like plagiarism. So this is belong to the ethic. It's an ethic issue that involves students.
Yes, 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 yes. It's a very interesting point. Not only in terms of plagiarism, but also in terms of guarantee that people that participate, for example, in case studies, in extracting quantitative data, are really involved in the process and really participate in the process and knows really the rules of the game. Okay. So, yes, yes, typically yes, and yes. So if you have typically an ethical commission, you have these four elements. After that appears concern about your company research or innovation. First one is about if you have concerns relate and report with health and safety concerns, ethical issues, risks. Depends also how do you implement company, but typically yes, makes sense. The typically you have a contact also you have this document, and also if you are performing investigation and research activities, so you have this one, and typically if you have a management system, you also need to have this one. Okay. And also appears an element that is in terms of decision making and the advisor board. So we have advisor board, it is interesting to know who is representing that. Customers, and here it is interesting because they address two different things. One thing is the customer, other thing is the end user. Sometimes the customer and the user are the same, but sometimes it's not exactly the same. Customer intends online altercation, and the end user possibly will be the same. Do you agree or not?
What do you mean end user representatives? People? That is there a tutor or something like that?
Well, let's look to business idea, online education. Who is the customer also online education?
Could be students or companies, because you can sell.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So let's move to companies because it is more complicated and it is more interesting to address this issue. Customer, is the company, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And the end user is not the company, because company only exists because they are humans working there, employees,
mm-hmm. okay?
So end user is the people that work at companies. Okay. So you may involve some representative of the customer, that is the representative of the company, but not the end user that will attend your course online. Okay. So it is important to have both. And this is, from my experience, including at University of Porto, it is a very interesting point. Because sometimes you need, typically you involve the customer because you want to represent someone that pays for something that you are developing, but you forget that the people that pay is not exactly people that are using. And sometimes the company pays something, but they don't adopt it because the end user didn't participate in the process. Okay, this is really a very interesting point. Civil society organizations, typically online education, in education, this is very important. Also this one, not exactly, it depends. If you want to demonstrate, for example, in online education, that you want to provide something that has really impact in the market, in terms of consumer market. It is not totally impossible, of course, but I think that it is not mandatory.
Yeah.
Same applies to here. National governments, it is very important. In education, it is a very important issue. For example, I give my example that I have currently. I have course that are audited and enrolled in A3S, that is the national government responsible to the accreditation of higher education in Portugal. And the government stabilized, or A3S stabilized, that a course can be online or can be presential, okay, in person or online. And if you have an in-person course, you can't have an online. So it is a major problem due to two things. The one important is that people with COVID-19, they need to attend sessions from home at distance. And this creates an additional issue in terms, for example, in terms of evaluation, because they can't do the evaluation online. Another important issue is about Erasmus. Erasmus and other programs of international students. Why? Because it is important. Because, for example, in Brazil, there are a lot of students that are attending from Brazil. So, but you can provide it online, they can't attend. Okay, so you have really not easy. This is a very important issue, not only in terms of online education, but in terms of higher education in Portugal, because the rules are very rigid. And I don't like to say that that students are customers, of course, but they pay, so they are customers, in fact, in terms of business interpretation. But really, the needs of our customers are not exactly aligned with the national government's legislation, okay? So, but in this case, it is important. International governing body is very important in terms of online education, okay? Very important that, because you want to have an online education that attracts students from different countries. And general public, typically, yes. Others, of course, there is always a section in all sort of others. Okay, let's move on to another domain, that is transparency. What is public or not regarding your activity? Source of funding, typically yes, in all education. Involvement of consortia or partnerships, typically it is public. In all education institutions. Assessed methodology is typically yes, yes, yes. I think that on education, it is really very important to have transparency, typically in all sub-domains. Okay? Any question until now?
May I ask, so you are the result of this is an index, probably, I think.
Yes, it's you can go to overview.
Yeah. Okay. So in transparency, you achieve the top.
Exactly.
Score.
It is common in a education institution in terms of transparency.
Yeah.
So it makes some sense.
So, but the model. Let me ask you: the model is for some for when you start the business, or could be more for a company that exists and want to expand their business, its business?
Yes, it is a very interesting question because the answer is yes or both questions. Initially, it is important to assess how we are responsible in terms of responsible innovation. But this is dynamic, okay? So it is also very important that, for example, once per year, you evaluate it again. Because some practices that you are implementing can be true in a given moment, but it can change. For example, I can give an example that it makes sense. And it appeared also in the context of my organization. 2 years ago, we didn't have a quality management system. After implementing a quality management system, and if you realize until this point, this will give a check and will have a huge impact in terms of responsible innovation.
Okay.
So it makes sense to reevaluate it again. Okay. So let's move to try to finish it. Data management in terms of how does your company ensure ethical management? If you share or not with third parties, this is an important. If you align it with the GDPR, okay? So if you implement it, you can assure that typically you are assuring that, okay? But GDPR is also not, it is also a dynamic process, okay? Mm-hmm. You have the example of Câmara Lisboa, yes, that you have that problem with data sharing. So it's not just a question to say that you comply with GDPR. It is also to demonstrate that you really apply. Okay. The nine group that does your company share research data with third parties or public good? That's the interesting point, that really your data is contributing for something in terms of social impact. Typically, yes, first part, first output data are made openly accessible. It is an interesting point, this one, and particularly for people that are working in education or students, it is interesting to know that. For example, Fundação Ciência e Tecnologia, that is the Portuguese entity that financially aid some public money to the first project, turn mandatory to turn everything that you publish in open access. Okay, so open access is mandatory. And it is also mandatory in the context of European research projects. But it's even an interesting issue because when you want to publish something in open access, you need to pay for that. Okay, so turning data public, okay, openly accessible, means indirectly that you are spending more money in your research activities. Do you agree with me or not? It is an interesting point that.
If I understand well, I don't know, but it is possible not to publicate because it's not a publication, but you can put the outputs of your research in a platform of European Union, and so then you can publish in a part that is not open access. But you have to, if it is financed by the Portuguese and European funds, you need to, Europeans have to have access, or people have to have access to these outputs, but not in a way of publication.
Yeah,
you can you put your paper in a stage that is not a publication, you can put it in that platform.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I recently published in an Emerald journal that Emerald has a policy related with that turns possible to publish, for example, the abstract, the findings of the project, of the study and publication, but it is not to publish all the paper because my option was not open access because I don't have money for that. That's the reason to publish it in open access. But really, it is possible to put public some elements, okay? So, but it's an interesting point because the consequence of using open access is turning science more expensive, okay?
Yeah.
Very competitive.
Because open access is something that the idea is good. Mm-hmm. But the results in practice, it seems for me that is not good. But this is my opinion, because I see people that don't have experience publishing in paying without revisions in mm-hmm. open access, indexed in Scopus and GCR. So I'm a little confused with this.
Yes,
I need to learn more.
Yes, I agree with you. We don't need to learn, but you need to be attentive with that, because it is interesting that because when you look to journal metrics and web access to journal metrics, you realize one thing, that they are journals that are open access, and they are journals that are not public access. There is associated commercial access. And you realize one interesting thing. If you look well to the numbers, we realize that typically it depends also on the field. But for example, in the field of innovation and entrepreneurship, that is my main field of research, we realize that the majority of journals, the acceptance rate that is public in some journals, not all, but some journals has this information, we realize that typically there is lower than 10% typically.
Mm.
But when you start to look into open access, you realize that the numbers are higher.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have looked. I have an invitation for a journal that is indexed to invitation in terms of publishing. I didn't understand the email. Then I have a look in the journal and I find an issue with 149 papers in one issue. So this is business. This is not research. This is business. So it was in the exit. So I need to learn more. I have to have a better opinion about this, because the idea of an open access is good. The idea is to diffuse the knowledge. The idea is good. So, but in practice, probably we have good publishers that are following strict rules, and we have another kind of editors that are in a different perspective.
Yes, I agree. Look, it is a very interesting point, especially in terms of responsible innovation, because a key question in terms of responsible innovation is ethical. So the ethical of some publishers are not totally clear, okay? So you have something that is really, in terms of possible innovation, that really turns difficult to implement possible innovation in all components, okay?
Yeah.
After that appears pre-competitive research that shared very interesting point also in online education and in education in general. Pre-competitive research data is shared. It means that probably that you go to business, you go to the market in partnership. Okay, this is an important. And if you look to PRR, Plano de Recuperação e Resiliência, all institutions that need to participate in it needs to have at least 5,000 students. So an university of Porto is easy, but for a smaller organization, not easy to have 5,000 students. It is also impossible. Okay.
Yeah.
So you need to work in a consortium. So you don't have another alternative. So if you want to compete with the market and address, for example, PRR program, you need to really check this one, or you can't compete. Okay. Or if you decide or not in case by case basis. Typically, yes, it is applied because it is not easy to stabilize an easy rule to apply to all. Science education, does your company engage in any activities I'm addressing public awareness about science behind your innovation? Okay, first one is clear. You are a whole university, so you collaborate with other universities. You should open door days for public. Typically, it is a good strategy for online education. You publish background information or give interview in a non-scientific media. In terms of advertising, it is very important. And this one is also important. Okay. And probably you'll have other activities. So let's put this one without clients, without putting here anything. Standards. How does your company address relevant standards and regulations related to your industry or product or service? It is a very interesting point regarding this course because there is also something new that was addressed in a seminar by Ricky Fernandez. Is the question of ISO, sorry, innovation management. So this is applied to all kinds of companies. When you look to education, you realize that it's an interesting point, this one. You choose an interesting topic that is online education and to give some discussion that is interesting is in terms of innovation. For example, and realizing the innovation management. If you have an industrial company, the innovation management process, or if you look in the context of UNESCO Tech, innovation process management is very important. But when you look to education institutions, you start to realize something interesting. Typically, something that provides knowledge about innovation, that is the one core activity of higher education institution, typically innovation entrepreneurship, you realize that these institutions are not so innovative. So you teach something, but you are not good in applying it. It makes some sense, and it happens in a lot of buildings. And here it is very important because if you want to apply a standard of innovation management to education institution, big question is, it makes sense to apply. What do you think about it?
In terms, in theoretical terms, it makes sense for me. But in practice, this is another problem because management in education institutions are elected, are not selected by their previous performance. So we have a problem with people that is leading, managing these organizations. They are elected. So this is I'm talking about public institutions, of course.
And private. Same thing or worse.
Yeah, but this is a problem. So because there are professors that don't have experience, some of them, most of them that I know, of course, have a low performance in academia in terms of publications, so they focus on management. And so this is a lack of experience, of international experience, a lack of and other issues that are related with education. And this is a problem, a big problem.
Yes.
This is my experience. I don't know. I would like to listen to other experience.
Well, my experience is exactly the same. And already I'm collaborating with several institutions, also in Portugal and in other countries. This is a problem. Because when you look to this point, that you look standards, you are expecting that in education institution applies with standards related to with innovation management. Okay, but in practical terms, this is not the case. The standards here, in terms of online education and education in general, and in terms of your accreditation.
Yeah.
And not exactly if you apply some standard in your innovation process, because sometimes innovation process doesn't exist. This is the big question. Okay, and some organizations implement some things that are isolatedly, that are initiatives that are interesting, but are isolatedly. Mm-hmm. For example, a suggestion box is interesting, but if you don't have more engines in system, it doesn't give to you anything, at least with impact. Okay. But if you apply with standards related with accreditation, you can check all of them. Mm-hmm. Diversity and equality. It is very important, the question in terms of gender, age, ethnicity, religion, physical abilities, marital status, sexuality. It's very important. Look, for institutions, this is a big issue. It is really a very big issue. UNESCOTEC didn't realize that until some years ago. But really, it is really a big, interesting issue in terms of UNESC, in terms of University of Porto, in terms of all institutions. Why? If you look to reality of UNESC and other institutions, you realize that, for example, in terms of gender equality, it is not easy to address. Why? For example, UNESCOTEC address essentially teams related with science, related to engineering. If you look, the number of women in higher education is higher than men, okay? But the distribution along the curves are not exactly the same. So you have more women in terms of education, humanities, social science. But in engineering and science, you don't have many women. So you have issues related to gender diversity, because your field of working is centered in terms of engineering, in terms of science. So it's not easy. And this has a huge impact, because the institutions that evaluate in UNESCOTEC, that was recently evaluated, and also that evaluate university institutions in Portugal and in other countries, don't look for that. They look if the gender equality is 70% or not. It is totally gender diversity or not. It isn't, so it must be improved. They don't look if your company or your institution is working in a field of engineering or science. This is really a big issue, because of course it has a huge impact. Okay. Mm-hmm. Typically you want to address. It depends on your online education, that is, for example, all in management, all in engineering, so you can have more problems or not related with that. But it's really an interesting point, because some of them look that it is easy to address, but in practical terms, it is not easy to address, even if you really care about gender equality and others. Because it depends on business. Okay.
Fernando, just a question. I think that this equal of the 1 in 12, in case of equal credentials among candidates, you give the position to, for example, underrepresented groups, for example, to a woman. Don't you think that is unfair? Why do you
depends,
have
depends.
To...
If the same applies with politics, that you include politics. If you want to win, to have incentives or that or not. If you are too far away to reach the minimal level, you need to create this kind of policies.
Yeah, but normally it's very difficult to evaluate the credentials and have two very equal candidates. You normally have very different curriculums for the position, and it's mostly, for example, in our case, we are a company. What you look the most is the fit of the expectations with the candidate to the expectations of the company, and the fit of the profile with the company. We don't think if it is a man or a woman or has any kind of physical disability, you know, but it's very difficult. For me, it's very difficult to say check to this one particularly, because you really don't have two equal CVs, and it's very difficult to say, okay, I will give it to the woman because, you know, and then it makes, for me, it makes more discrimination, I would say.
So, yes, I agree totally. It is a big issue that appeared not in Europe, but in United States. United States company, the government stabilized some rules related with that. And they need to, when they recruit someone, they need to really... It is really not easy, because they really need to demonstrate that all the process related with non-discriminatory was adopted.
Yeah.
Okay.
But sometimes this ends as a discriminatory process, because she was chosen because she was a woman, not because she was the good one. And this is very unfair, but please go on. We can stay here.
Yes, I agree totally with you. It is really an interesting topic. And
let me share something about. I was thinking like you. I don't know the name of the
Rosa. I'm Rosa.
Rosa,
I'm an engineer, and I really need to work hard in this world of
yes. In the beginning, I thought it was my idea, because I think it could be a discrimination for women, because you can think she's here because she is a woman. But if you don't have these kind of rules, you don't change things. And for instance, in Portugal, in the deputies, the assembly, you have these kind of rules. And so in the beginning, people criticize, but now you have an improvement in this point. So sometimes you need some drastic rules to advance some steps, otherwise you don't advance, or because you always have an excuse, because man is better than woman, so he is more prepared. Of course, if you have more resources in more people, male prepared, of course you have more choice to have more opportunities to choose from men, okay, from male. So you have to change something, and sometimes these kind of rules are, for me, are needed.
Yes, I agree totally.
How that can help.
Yes, it is a really interesting topic. Also, the debate, it is not easy to reach a consensus, because there is no consensus about it, but it's very interesting. And it is having a lot of impact, for example, at Inesco Tech. And also at the University of Porto, and also at other institutions in Europe and the United States. Okay,
let's move
to another category, because there are a lot of questions, but just to have another overview. For example, when you move to idea generation and research, important thing here is prioritizing societal challenge. For example, if you are prioritizing new ideas or products or services, for example, related with online education that's serving user needs, typically, yes, you are proposing something that really are interesting to users. Things potential to alleviate societal or environmental challenges, typically, yes, because you want that people participate in online education and give them to more opportunity. They can be, for example, in a different country. Okay. How does your company identify societal standards and the company roles in alleviating them? Okay. In terms of also important, the question would relate to United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, if you are addressing these goals or not. Typically, I can say yes. This one also yes. Long-term vision. Cooperation with experts in the field, typically in education, makes sense. And external stakeholders. Look that stakeholders appears in a lot of questions. It is a very important topic. Involvement of stakeholders. And here appears the, also another concept, very interesting, that is easy to different them. That is shareholders and the stakeholders, okay? Stakeholders, all the parts interesting, and shareholders, people that really has capital of the company. The involvement of shareholders, if they are involved, typically makes sense to be involved. Sometimes they're involved too late. This creates new problems, of course. Customers, users, that the notion of customers and users appear also here. Supply chains, partners. Okay, experts also, government, yes, yes. Typically, yes, in all this kind, in this kind of business, of course. In which roles are groups in the people's creation involving the Asian generation? How they are involved in the process of creation of new ideas? So, for example, they are in some of such topics on process? Typically, yes. They provide the information. So, for example, if they participate in market research activity or focus group, it is common in higher education, feedback or process. Okay, there are a lot of questions. The idea is not to look to all of them. Just move to another topic that is more important to see the headlines. Anticipating impact. That's you anticipate the impact of your positive and negative impact of your product or service that you are creating or innovating. Okay, this is another interesting point that is addressed here. Let's move to another topic. Reviewing and adapting. How does your company encourage employees to reflect on the company research and innovation? In education, typically, and looking to online education, if employees are encouraged to develop alternative solutions to identify problems. It is an interesting point. I believe that most education institutions really are not in practical terms adopting it. It is the process of reviewing process that are adopting and adapt eating to the new needs. Okay, it's something interesting, but this section, this dimension, looks to the process, the ideas generation and research. Typically, it is more common, this approach, not on in online education, of course, but it's also important, but also in industrial environments. After the idea generation and research appears the development and testing. And here appears also stakeholders, developing with stakeholders. Interesting point. When you create, for example, the idea here is to involve stakeholders in the agile innovation process. Looking to agile. For example, they test prototypes or pilots of new products or service. For example, you create a new course and you share the prototype or pilot with your stakeholders. Okay, this is interesting. So you develop with them. What do you think also with the involvement of stakeholders in development process in terms of education? They participate, they don't participate. What are the issues? Someone want to say something about it?
If it is a something very innovative, you need it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
If it is something more standard, probably you follow others. So we are a follower of other computers. So, but if it is a new idea, a very innovative idea, I think you have to test more and you have to involve these different people.
Yes, I agree totally with you. Look, they are two dimensions that are not exactly the same, but they are interconnected. One thing is the generation. You have the participation of stakeholders in the process of generation of any new ideas. If you apply to online education, for example, creation of new course. And after that, you have the process of developing it and testing. What can be the testing? Testing is an interesting question in education. There is a testing says in education. What do you think?
You can inform about your ideas and you can receive contributions of it.
But
so it's not a typical a pilot. I think could be a pilot case. You can have a pilot case and you receive contributions to improve it.
Yes, but looking to the education. Look, education is an interesting case because the testing says doesn't exist in practical terms because you create a new course, okay?
Yeah.
You put it all in the market. How do you test it? You test it when you are in the market. This is not exactly the concept of testing. To testing it before, okay? So you don't test anything. You expect that what you propose in your idea generation.
You can test in a small group. You can advance like a pilot. You can have more locally or more European experience, and then you can expand it. So.
Yes, it is possible. Like, for example,
yeah, like a pilot, like in the companies, the innovation is located in a organization area and for improving knowledge about it, and then you diffuse in the entire company. It could also be like this.
Yes, I agree totally. It is interesting because you can propose a new course in the context of one organization, of your own company, and if things work well, you can move to another. Okay?
This is common, right? for instance, for master's courses, people usually start with a post-graduation. If there is market, then they advance for master. They go for master, so.
Yes. It's typically a strategy. It is not exactly the same thing, because the public of post graduation is also not exactly the same as master, but it is an approach followed by many organizations. Implementing safeguards, how does your company try to prevent an unintended use of it in the process or service? It applies more with industrial partners. Sustainable production and sourcing, also, and review and adapting. Okay, and also the last component is about market and impact. And really it is, for example, the third thing, contributing to solving societal challenges. Which of solving social aspects do your company innovation support? Employee opportunities, yes, for example. Equally, that's the hot topic. Societal cohesion and solidarity, yes. Poverty, employment opportunities, it's duplicate. This one, there is an issue here. Access to housing or improved housing conditions doesn't make good sense. Indirectly, yes, it is interesting at this point, because in COVID-19, we realized that not only holy house and only where people live, as conditions to access to online education, OK? Okay, so it is an indirect way to improve the housing conditions, indirectly. Access to products or service, healthcare, education, of course, gaining government and autonomy, personal privacy, for example, okay? So there are some components that can be, that you can realize that if you are contributing to solving societal challenges or not. Okay, there are other components minimizing negative effects. For example, does your company ensure that potential negative impact is minimized once an innovation is on market? And the last part is the process of reviewing and adapting. For example, how does your company ensure continuous improvement? And continuous improvement is also very important. Look, that it is an interesting point because agile innovation also a central, a key point in agile innovation is continuous improvement. And also the question relates to evaluation and feedback to improve your products and service. So that's the idea. You have here the overview and you realize what you are having good performance and others that you need to improve and gives a score in four components. For example, in this case, because it was, you have more time to look for that, company management is where the company has a better score and developing and testing is perhaps not mean exactly that the responsible innovation practices are implemented. It can also say that development and testing is less important to your company because they're less important. You don't care so much about it. So you don't apply responsible innovation in a long way. Okay, I will stop sharing my screen. Questions that you may have? I think it was an interesting exercise.
Do you advise to do this annually or in the larger periods? Do you think it should for each innovation, for a business area or for a more complex business? How do you apply it if it is a combination of innovations, for instance? You advise to do it one by one or as a pack? Is your opinion?
Okay, thank you very much for the question. There are two questions. First one is when to make it. I think it is important to make to start making it when you are implementing a startup, for example, you are creating a startup like this one at this phase. To realize that there are some questions that you don't know how to answer very well. So it gives some interesting points to you to improve. The other question was related to if you need to apply it to an innovation or to the company. My opinion is that you need to apply this Excel typically to the company and not just to an innovation. So there are questions related to the company and not just to one innovation. And probably if you do that when you start to create a startup, one time per year, I think it is adequate to think that really if you need to improve some parts and others that make sense or not. Okay.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Okay, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed not only this presentation or workshop, that was more workshop practical approach. Thank you very much for the participation in this workshop and also in the course. I expect that it was great and it gives more perspectives about a topic that is related to responsible innovation and not only innovation, but look to the innovation with impact in terms of societal, environmental, cultural, other domains, not only for the business proposal. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, bye.